us there. We spoke of was and when, although I wasn't there. He said I was his friend, which came as some surprise. I spoke into his eyes. I thought you'd die alone a long, long time ago. Oh no, not me. I never lost control. Your face to face with the man who sold the world.
Chapter 23. Jeff found himself in front of an open refrigerator in the middle of the night. He gathered his provisions and began cooking. A faceless HR persona left several voicemails for him in the coming days and eventually weeks. Then came some legal paperwork and a justifiably tense phone call with Sam. While listening to the bacon crackle, he was reminded by a glowing green microwave clock that it was 3 a.m. His wife appeared on the staircase. She leaned over and looked into the kitchen.
"Breakfast?"
Jeff asked.
"You're a fool," she said.
She went back to bed and Jeff ate. He fried more bacon and finished the toast. Those were the last words they spoke to each other. He could not remember if it was before or after his fling with Carol. It didn't matter. It was easier for her to leave. His daughter was an afterthought, and his wife wanted to bring her to a new place, where the transition would be easier with family. At sunrise, the pop of a beer can opening echoed through his empty home. He stayed in the basement until the house was empty. He listened to the uncomfortable grunts and fake moans of an amateur, male-dominated threesome for an hour before making coffee. When he got to a drive-thru, he was already sweating whiskey through his shirt. He waited for the lunch menu to go into effect, and he attacked the dollar menu by breaking a 20. An orgy of mayonnaise, apple pies, and ketchup swirled in his refuse. The imprint from his digging belt turned purple under his growing white belly. He took a quick nap amongst the fast food wrappers on his seat while parked outside a strip club. In the daylight, it was a sex shop, but the owner kept a few nudie booths running. It was the last peep show in town, a call to a bygone era. When Jeff's father was murdered, the city of Philadelphia and the Philadelphia Police Department helped for a few years, but his mother and sister burned through most of the pension fund on a vacation home in Ocean City, New Jersey. Jeff hated the beach. His father had as well. His mother and sister mounted a campaign to keep his father's memory. Esquire had a brief election cycle when he donated heavily to both the police unions and the Randolph Foundation. Jeff could not bring himself to cry in public, or be so stoic as to stand with the hard right conservatives donning badges and calling for blood in the name of his absent, alcoholic father. Jeff was disinterested in most of it. Esquire, a former adversary, intrigued him, so he got his foot in the door. People for Good provided an exciting start, and Jeff remained a royal, if prodigal, son of the PPD. Tufts of pubic hair, soft skin, Carol's neck, Eileen's pink nipples, Charlotte's hips, Jessica's smile, the musky whiffs of hot sex. Jeff's imagination sped up while trying to masturbate in his driver's seat unsuccessfully until he dozed off. When he woke, he checked his rearview. The familiar black leather boots of his favorite dancer were crossing the oil-stained asphalt. She recognized his car by now. It had been 3 weeks in a row. This was the first time he was there before she was. When the dancer walked through the doors, she cautioned the manager to be especially vigilant. "The early bird's here," she said. The manager stroked the shotgun under the register and gave a reassuring nod. The dancer made her way to the back. Her boots clunked over the old wooden ramp. She turned up the volume on the sound system and exploded into her purple room. Heavy metal guitar and bass strings shook through the speakers while the curtain scrolled to introduce her, and pink neon lights hid the life experience on her thighs. Their game had a routine. Jeff would flaunt his pittance, and she would enter the room. The lap dance was intense. The mixture of her leather shorts and moisturized, soft, thick thighs aroused him. She was into him at first glance, but less attracted and weirded out when she saw the wrinkles in his face. She liked the stubble on his bald head. She was turned on by the attention, but aware of his sadness. She straddled him and put her cheek to his. "You gotta have a better place to be." She arched her back and caught the tear welling in his eye. She wanted him to dismiss her suggestion. Then she remembered him. "Hey, you're that dude from the center." Jeff was mute. "Yeah. You coached basketball back in the day." "Jesus Christ," Jeff said. During his playing days, he wore his head clean-shaven to shapeshift between the skinheads near his home and the predominantly black neighborhoods where he played basketball. He was intimidating until he made eye contact. On the court, he earned the nickname Mr. Clean, which stuck because of his penchant for assists, rebounding, and avoiding fouls, at least the ones the ref saw. He never led the team, nor did he have a breakout performance that caught the eyes of scouts. But he earned the respect of his peers. The job evolved from spending most of his time at the rec center. Sam understood that home life was not perfect, but he remained intent on not assuming a mentor role. Jeff became a coach and kept to himself. He wore his fear of rejection on his sleeve. The good center was a refuge, and when things changed, it stood still. Agony and ecstasy competed at both ends of the court. A ballet of balance between power and finesse entertained the crowds. When he caught the attention of the girls on the sidelines, his game suffered. His first experience may not have been of age, and the regret sat with him for his entire life. He hugged the dancer and she could feel him crying. She kissed the top of his head. "It's okay," she assured him. "It's okay." All sexual tension between them was released. He was a broken man, fixing it the only way he ever knew. He peeled out of the parking lot. The sun was bright and he needed a dark bar to ride out the day. Jeff was most at home inside a bar. While the sun was still up, he blended ambition and fun better than his peers, and he could never get ahead. They outgrew the pubs, and he hunted for new clients, young guys trying to connect and show off for one another. Folk music and the chatter of union foremen made you assert yourself. New clients and the rich bastards who came to the board meeting were burying the demons. Some of them did, while others were forced to sell at any cost. He was there with them. With his Lexus parked in front of the FOP Lodge, he swigged from a nearly empty bottle of Canadian Club. He couldn't resist a donor meeting. This one was purely for the booze. Some retired cop made it big in the waste management business and made substantial donations to People for Good. Jeff checked a few boxes to doctor his paperwork and gave him double the tax credit. In exchange, Jeff's lifestyle never had to catch up with him. Until now. The booze flowed around between so many O'Briens, Fitzgeralds, and McShays. They either exuded machismo or could barely fit into their seats. Racist remarks, subtle and obvious, floated through the air. The only time a black cop stopped in was for a no-judgment mid-shift beer. Even then, he was alone. This old boys' club wasn't what Jeff was used to. He saw some of it growing up, but never subscribed. These guys would rent the rec center for a few hours from him. They knew each other in passing. Double tax refunds in a pinch, shelter corporations and in-kind excess, this was the worst of it. An accounting nightmare for a smaller nonprofit, but a mere fixable error for people for good. There was danger in an idle mind, and the more Jeff schemed, the more idle he felt. Coke was an option, but a dark path. His head was pounding. Shot after shot made him zoom out more. "Honesty is gone," Jeff mumbled. His former client was embarrassed. The young man was just out of college and hoping for some advice about something more. What he got was a washed-out, sullen, middle-aged man in the throes of a nervous breakdown. He picked up the tab and left his business card. Jeff's head swayed above the floor. The patrons pretended not to notice, but they all knew it was a bad day. Word had not reached them of his firing, but they could assume. He moved to another place, where they had the decency not to progress past a pint glass. The working-class crowd wondered when he dismissed decorum. Familiar faces from the neighborhood were there, and he kept to himself. "Jeff, here." The bartender gave him a glass of water and took mercy on him. Local news blared from a mounted television in the corner. The breaking story told of a botched robbery at the peep show and a shotgun misfire that left a dancer dead. That's how they described her. A dancer. Jeff didn't know her as anything else, but he knew she was more than a dancer. No one blinked an eye. Glasses went up and glasses went down. Jeff could not process the news due to the intensity of a room full of eyes on him. He felt the respect of his fellow drunks fading away. "Jeff, choke it down. Move on," he whispered to himself. "Who gives a fuck?" he asked. "No one." He thought of that poor girl, bloody on the floor of the place she hated more than her home. Jeff stumbled out of the bar and vomited at the end of the two-block walk to his car. He slunked in his seat and listened to some motivational speaker on talk radio spouting positivity. "Create a narrative for yourself and live it. It doesn't matter where you have been. This is about who you meet along the way and how you can network to build something more." The cynic in Jeff had come to find the opposite. Networking was an empty act amid a frustrating search. He did not have much faith in others, given the rejection and self-righteousness he experienced. He had somewhere to be, and he'd eventually find his way there when he remembered. Jessica met him at the hotel bar on the night of the People for Good gala. Black sequins grazed the top of her thigh. She was elegant, with a silver clutch pressed between her hip and wrist. Jeff wore a rumpled gray suit and a darkening 5 o'clock shadow. His recent texts were a mix of incoherent, depressed, and romantic rambling amid a barrage of dick pics. "Dearest Jessica," he wrote recently, "I want to love you, but I find myself incapable of loving anyone." She alternated between crying, masturbating, and making her best attempt to match his drinking. Sadness overcame her on a night when she drove past his darkened home that was illuminated only by a flickering television hidden behind drawn curtains. "You know you shouldn't be here," she warned. "It's a public place." Jessica looked over her shoulder at the guests trickling into the ballroom. Security was surely aware of Jeff's presence, but they would not do anything for fear of negative attention. Jeff ordered her a drink. She leaned in closer to him. "Why haven't you called me?" she asked. "What do you think this is?" "We fucked," he answered. "You don't want more?" "Do you want this? Me? Right now?" "Yes." "It won't work, Jessica." "It could," she pleaded.
I thought you were different, he said. She did not take kindly to his criticism, but held back, showing her emotion. You all want to change us, Jeff said. You love the idea of it, but you have no idea how much work it takes. Then you don't want it. You want the house, the car, the kids, and you. Enough! You don't know what I want. You don't know anything about me.
You are a fantasy, he mumbled.
A what?
A fantasy.
Turns out, you're just a woman.
And you're a shell of a man, she said. Have a nice life.
Or whatever's left of it.
They toasted to her insult, and Jessica disappeared into a sea of well-dressed guests climbing the escalator to the ballroom. The aristocrats were never for him, because he struggled to believe he belonged. He caught a glimpse of Chairman and his blonde wife on a balcony, shaking hands and flashing their veneers. He slugged back his bullet and then asked for something cheaper. Automatic hotel doors parted for Carol, who entered in a sleek purple gown. With his lips pressed to his bottom shelf swill, he locked eyes with Carol. She broke her own gaze from the chairman and his rekindled romance, while stifling her disappointment. Jeff, again, offered a distraction, so she approached him.
Need a plus one? Jeff asked.
How about I see you when the ball drops? She countered.
Right up there.